Hello friends, good morning, welcome you all to another video, and today we are going to continue with a paper number 4. And as you know that we have started from previous week the poem Valediction Forbidding Morning by John Donne. And as you know that this poem is about the separation of two lovers, and how a lover is convincing a beloved that how even though he is going far away, but he will be with her, he loves her, there will be no difference between his love. And at the yesterday lecture we have came to know that he was comparing his love with the compass. And now the last two stanzas of this poem today we are going to see, and after that we also cover all the things about this poem in this today's lecture. So let's get started. So now I'm reading the stanza, two stanzas, and then it is a very, you know, the simplicit stanzas, very simple meaning of this stanzas you can see. And though it is in the center seat, it when the other far doth roam, it leans and hearkens after it, and grows erect as that comes home. Such wilt thou to be me, who must like the other foot obliquely run. Thy firmness makes my circle just, and makes me end where I begin. So okay, so in the second last stanza we can see that here he is comparing the two foots of the compass. So one foot is a beloved who is a fixed, and the second foot is the lover. Okay, so and though it is center seat, center that is the beloved, and it when the other far doth roam, so roaming, who just wandering here and there, who will go far away, that is lover. Okay, it leans and hearkens after it, and grows erect as that comes home. Okay, so when he was doing to circle it, but whenever he comes to home, it get erect. Okay, so that is the reunion of the two those lovers. Okay, so like that, such wilt thou to me, who must like the other foot obliquely run. Okay, so now he just saying that he is the other foot who is obviously run, he will he will run, but the firmness that is the beloved, who is the center foot with the firm layer, even though he run from that first foot, he will in the circle, and it will come when it began. So therefore their love is like a circle, their love is like a compass, and therefore he will start a journey, but he will come back to her again. So that is actually his talking. So the firmness of the center, or we can say his lover's soul is the fixed foot in the center, and his is the foot that moves around it. The firmness of the center foot make the circle, and that the outer foot draws perfect. Thy firmness makes my circle just, and makes me end where I begin. So that is the thing. So let's talk about the form of this poem. So you know that there are 9 stanzas of this poem, and if you compare to many of his poem, so in this poem also the strange material patterns overlaid jarringly on regular rhyme scheme. So here each 4-line stanza is quite unordered, with an A-B-A-B rhyme scheme and an iambic tetrameter you can see here. So if we talk about the commentary, so you know that the Valediction Forbidding Meaning is one of the Donne's most famous and simplest poem, and also probably his most direct statement of his idol of spiritual love. For his erotic certain poems such as the Philae, it is different. Donne proposed a devotion to a kind of spiritual love, and the Philae is actually the physical love. It is about the physical love, and the valediction is kind of a spiritual love. So we can say that a physical separation from his beloved, he invokes the nature of that spiritual love to ward off the tear floods and sigh tempest that might otherwise attend on their farewell. The poem is essentially a sequence of metaphors and comparison, each describing a way of looking at their separation that will help them to avoid the mourning forbidden by the poem's title. So here we can say that at the beginning, the farewell should be as mild as an uncomplaining death of virtuous man. For to weep would be a profanation of all our joys. And next stanza, The speaker compares harmful moving of the earth to innocent trepidation of the spears. And again, equating the first with the dull subnary lover's love and the second with their love, inter-assured of mind. Like the rumbling earth, the dull subnary, meaning literally beneath the moon and also subject to the moon, lovers are all physical, unable to experience separation without losing the sensation that comprises and sustains the love. But the spiritual lovers, careless eyes, lips and hands to miss, because like the trepidation, vibration of the spheres, the concentrated globes that surrounded the earth in ancient astronomy, their love is not wholly physical. Also like the trepidation of the spheres, their movement will not have the harmful consequences of an earthquake. So here we can say that the speaker then declares that since the lovers, two souls are one, his departure will simply expand the area of their unified soul rather than cause a rift between them. If, however, their souls are two instead of one, they are as the feet of a tractor compass connected with the center foot, fixing the orbit of the outer foot and helping it to describe a perfect circle. The compass, the instrument used for drawing circles, is one of the Donne's most famous metaphors, and it is a perfect image to encapsulate the values of Donne's spiritual love, which is balanced, symmetrical, intellectual, serious, and beautiful in its polished simplicity. So let's talk about the themes, motifs, and symbols of this poem. So the first theme is lovers as a microcosmos. So Donne incorporates the Renaissance notion of the human body as a microcosmos into his love poetry. During the Renaissance, many people believed that the microcosmic human body mirrored the microcosmic physical world. According to this belief, the intellect governed the body much like a king or queen governed the land. Many of Donne's poems, most notably The Sun Rising, which was published in 1633, The Good Marrow in 1633, A Valediction of Weeping, again in the same year, envision a lover or pair of lovers as being entire worlds unto themselves, but rather than use the analogy to imply that the whole world can be compressed into a small space. Donne uses it to show how lovers become so interrupted with each other that they believe they are the only beings in existence. The lovers are so in love that nothing else matters. For example, in The Sun Rising, the speaker concludes the poem by telling the sun to shine exclusively on himself and his beloved. By doing so, he says the sun will be shining on the entire world. The Neoplatonic conception of love, Donne draws, this is the second thing. So Donne draws on the Neoplatonic conception of physical love and religious love as a being two manifestation of the same impulse. In the Symposium, or we can say that the 3rd or 4th century BC, Plato described physical love as the lowest rung of ladder. According to Platonic formulation, we are attracted first to a single beautiful person, then to beautiful people generally, then to beautiful minds, then to beautiful ideas, and ultimately to beauty itself. The highest rung of the ladder, centuries later, Christian neophilologists adopted this idea, such as the progression of love cumulates in love of God or spiritual beauty. Naturally, Donne used his religious poetry to idealize the Christian love for God, but the Neoplatonic conception of love also appears in his love poetry, albeit slightly tweaked. For instance, in the badly elegy 19 to his mistress going to bed, the speaker claimed that his love for a naked woman surpasses pictorial representation of biblical senses. Many love poems assert the superiority of the speaker's love to Cotidian ordinary love by presenting the speaker's love as a manifestation of pure Neoplatonic feeling, which resembles the sentiment felt for the divine. The third theme of this poem is religious enlightenment as sexual ecstasy. Throughout his poetry, Donne imagines religious enlightenment as a form of sexual ecstasy. He parallels the sense of fulfillment to be derived from religious worship to pleasure derived from sexual activity. A shocking revolutionary comparison for his time, in Holy Sonnet 14, for example, the speaker asks God to rape him, thereby freeing the speaker from worldly concern. Through the act of rape, paradoxically, the speaker will render chaste. In Holy Sonnet 18, The speaker draws an analogy between entering the one true church and entering a woman during intercourse. Here, the speaker explains that Christ will be pleased if he speaks sleep with Christ's wife, who is embraced and open to most men. Although these poems seem profane, their religious fervor saves them from, say, sacrilege or scandal. Filled with religious passion, people have the potential to be as leisurely seated as they are after sexual activity. And the fourth theme, that is the last theme, that is the search for the one true religion. Dunn's speaker frequently wonder which religion to choose when confronted with the so many churches that claim to be one true religion. In 1517, an Augustinian monk in Germany named Martin Luther set off a number of debates that eventually led to the founding of Protestantism, which at the time was considered to be the reform version of Catholicism. England developed Anglicanism in 1534, another reform version of Catholicism. This period was thus dubbed the Reformation because so many sects and churches developed from these religions. Theologians and lay people began to wonder which religion was true or right. Written while Dunn was abandoning Catholicism for Anglicanism, Satatri reflects this concern. So here the speaker wonders how one might discover the right church when so many churches make the same claim. The speaker of Holy Sonnet 18 asks Christ to explain which bride or church belongs to Christ. Now the poem thoughtfully proposes one church as representing the true religion, but nor does either poem reject outright the notion of one true church or religion. So if you talk about the motive, so first motive is space. Dunn's fascination with space rests partly on the perfection of these shapes and partly on the near infinite association that can be drawn from them. Like other metaphysical poets, Dunn used conceit to extend analogies and to make thematic connection between otherwise dissimilar objects. For instance, the good morrow, the speaker through brilliant and metaphysical lives uses the motive of spare to move from a description of the world to a description of gloves, to a description of his beloved eyes, to a description of their perfect love. Rather than simply praise his beloved, the speaker compares her to faultless shape, the spare, which contain neither corner nor edges. Next was discovery and conquest. Particularly in Dunn's love poetry, voyages of discovery and conquest illustrate the mystery and magnificence of the speaker's love affairs. European explorers began arriving in the Americas in the 15th century, returning to England and the continent with the previously unimagined treasures and stories. By Dunn's lifetime, colonies had been established in North and South America, and the richness that flocked back to England dramatically transformed England's society. In Good Tomorrow and The Sun Rising, the speakers expressed indifference toward recent voyages of discovery and conquest, preferably to seek adventures in bed with their beloveds. This comparison demonstrates the way in which the beloved body and personality prove endlessly fascinating to a person falling in love. Okay, then the reflection. Throughout his love poetry, Dunn makes reference to reflection that appears in eyes and tears. With this motive, Dunn emphasizes the way in which beloveds and their perfect love might contain one another, forming complete whole words. A valediction of weeping portrays the process of love occurring between the two lovers. As the speaker cries, he knows that image his beloved is reflected in his tears, and as the tear falls away, so to will speaker move farther away from his beloved until they are separated at last. The reflection in their eyes indicate the strong bond between the lovers in Good Morrow and the ecstasy. The lovers in this poem looked into one another's eyes and see themselves contained there, whole and perfect and present. The act of staring into each other's eyes led to profound mingling of souls in the ecstasy. Okay, the symbol. So there is angel, the compass is another symbol. Let's talk about the angels. So angels symbolize the almost divine status attained by believers in Dunn's love poetry. As divine messengers, angels meditate between God and humans, helping humans become closer to the divine. The speaker compares his beloved to an angel, to his mistress going to bed. Here the beloved as well as his love for her brings the speaker closer to God. The compass, perhaps the most famous conceit in all of the metaphysical poetry, the compass symbolizes the relationship between lovers, two separate but joined bodies. The symbol of the compass is another instance of Dunn's using the language of voyage and conquest to describe relationship between and feelings of those in love. Compasses help sailors navigate the sea, and metaphorically they help lovers stay link across physical distance or absence in a valediction forbidding morning. The speaker compares his soul and the soul of his beloved to a so-called twin compass, also known as the draftsman compass. A twin compass has two legs. One stays fixed and one that moves. In the poem, the speaker becomes the moving leg, while his beloved becomes the fixed leg. According to the poem, the jointure between them and the steadiness of his beloved allow the speaker to trace a perfect circle while he is apart from her. Although the speaker can only trace this circle when the two legs of the compass are separated, the compass can eventually be closed up and the two legs pressed together again after the circle has been traced. Then the blood is also actually it symbolizes life, and then uses blood to symbolize the different experiences. So hey guys, I think you understood the themes and all these things of this poem, forbidden valediction forbidding morning. So let's stop here. Thank you very much.